Isn't the real cause of crime poverty or form of insanity? Think about this now. No economically comfortable person would want to steal, nor would a person in their right mind want to break a law. Wouldn't it be better if we do away with the jails and use this money to cure the criminals through psychotherapy, forms of group therapy, put the money in job training programs rather than through incarceration and punishment? Think about that. Well, young man, this is your third felony conviction in the last 3 years.
Well, I'm sorry.
I'm going to be forced to give you a much longer suspended sentence this time. Well, gentlemen, this inmate hasn't committed any armed robberies, rapes, or murders in the last 5 years.
Yeah, that's because we've had his rotten ass locked up for the last 5 years.
Now, come on. Only by showing trust, understanding, and forgiveness can we expect him to show trust, understanding, forgiveness. Isn't that right, Dan?
Well, I don't know about that, but the prison is overcrowded, and we've got 10 new inmates coming in tomorrow.
Punishing criminals is not the answer. It's the cheap Saturday night specials that cause all the crime. Yeah! Ban these guns and we'll stop all crime. Yeah!
The weapon we hope you will never have to face as a law enforcement officer is a belt-fed machine gun. If you ever should happen to run into a big-time terrorist, drug smuggler, whatever, with one of these, there's not too much you can do except kill them, and you got to do it as fast as you can. These weapons have many strong points and only a few weak points. The weak points is they're not capable of really accurate fire, such like a scoped rifle. The other only other weak point is, and you pick this up, you want to talk like, hey, yo, Adrian, hey. Anyway, we'll crank off a little bit of the M60 here.
Other than artillery support or an airstrike, the best way to attack a machine gun is with a scoped rifle. Heck, I bet some of you can even hit things on purpose.
If you think that's bad, meet his bigger brother, the Browning 50 caliber. And let's see what we got here. Again, the best way to...
Skip Bain was the first Magnum save. He would not be the last.
Look out! Shoot! You got my gun!
Give it up! Give it up!
Skip, you're the first known officer to be shot with a .357 Magnum. What did it feel like when you were hit?
It was like somebody poking me real hard in the chest. I was braced for it, and it didn't knock me down or anything. And then I fired a shot at where I thought he was, where he'd been standing when he shot me, and he had already hidden behind a car. And I fired two more, but I was able to to return the fire, and I was never disabled. I was never knocked down. I was never, never in any pain.
The shooting actually took place when, at night?
It took place about 3 o'clock in the morning.
3 o'clock in the morning. Right. How come you weren't in bed?
Well, I was working burglary patrol.
Okay. You're working on burglary patrol. Yeah. How come they weren't in bed?
They were the burglars.
Okay.
Okay, the first bullet is the traditional 22 long rifle, fired from a rifle at extremely close range. Second, I'm going to go to the, let's try the 38 special. I can see the 22 long rifle actually penetrated more than the 38 special. 22 went through two boards, but not three. The 38 special's only gone through one. Of course, it makes a bigger hole. Now we'll move on up to the 357 Magnum. More impact there. The 357 Magnum has gone through two, but not through the third. Let's try the 9mm full metal jacket. The bullet is not very good for knocking people down, but not very good for incapacitating people, but it's pretty good in penetration. Okay, we have two penetrated, three, and just barely, it's just sticking out the back of the fourth. It did not quite penetrate the fourth board. It's a 2-inch thick pine board. Now I'm going to try a new one, the 10mm, which does have some considerable stopping power, if there is such a thing. It's not quite as good a penetration, I don't think. And the 10mm has penetrated two of the boards and just barely sticking out the back of the third. Quite similar to the 9. In fact, here the bullet is. Bear with me a second. Here it is right here. There's your 10mm through 6 inches of pine. What we've got here is something you'll probably never see. As one writer put it, this gun will never be issued to policemen unless Clint Eastwood is chief of police and Charles Bronson's the mayor. It's a 45 Winchester Magnum Grizzly Mark I. It's been especially magnum-ported for me. It's my personal favorite go-anywhere, do-anywhere, anything gun. It shoots a 230-grain full metal jacket bullet, 45 caliber, of course, at 1,400 feet a second at the muzzle. And we're going to put this against these 10 inches of pine with a gallon jug of milk behind it. Now, this is the second chance Super Featherweight 2, introduced brand new here in the fall of 1988. Incredibly thin, incredibly light. You can sleep in this thing. You've already stopped the 44 Magnum here. Oops. As you can see, the impact would be severe. But again, about the same as getting punched real hard. It would be severe. If you're a very thin person, you should have a thicker vest than this. But the bullet is in there, about halfway in. That's a bullet which I personally killed a beefalo, a 1,200-pound animal with a few months ago, with one shot. And that is probably about 5 to 10 times the power of what the average American policeman is being killed with today.
And now for a little comedy relief, we're going to present a lighthearted look at the American law enforcement officer as seen by 8 various groups. At least one of these imaginary scenes is certain to offend somebody, but please don't be offended. I really think that a sense of humor is necessary to maintain your sanity in this deadly serious business of ours. What is comedy? Webster's Dictionary defines comedy as that form of entertainment which is used to...
Well, you want to go to the coffee shop and get some donuts?
No, let's get them kids. They're going a mile over the speed limit.
All right.
Geez, Corbin, you know, with your job and your homework and your football practice all the time, I never get to see you anymore.
Well, I gotta get that scholarship to U of M like you did. Police are behind us.
I wonder what they could want.
Step on out of the car.
Step out, please.
There, sir. Put your hands on the hood.
Put your hands on the hood over here.
What did you do?
1 mile over the speed limit.
I'm late for PE lessons.
Just for 1 mile over the speed limit?
That's all it takes, one time.
Truck?
Yes, I did. What about that?
Don't worry about that. That's a pet's problem over there.
Look at the purple smoke.
Oh, that's the EPA's problem. Don't worry about it.
Nerve gas.
Steve, on the day you went to work, the day of the incident, did you feel anything unusual was going to happen?
No, I was due for a week off.
Were you wearing a vest on the day you went to work?
Yes.
What type of vest?
It was the old second chance vest. He got out of the car, he butted me in the side of the head. With the butt, it kind of knocked me off balance a little bit. And as I grabbed him, he spun around, and of course, that's when I seen the weapon.
Where'd the weapon come from?
I recognize it as my own.
Did you ever feel him take it from the holster you were wearing?
Never.
And what type of weapon were you carrying that day?
It was a 357 Smith & Wesson.
And what was it loaded with?
357's 110 grain.
What did he do when he pulled the weapon from your holster?
I don't know. I didn't know he had the weapon. It just came up from nowhere, and I recognized it as my weapon.
What was the next thing that happened?
He stuck it against my chest and fired.
Did you feel the impact of the bullet?
It felt like being hit with a cue stick. Just somebody poking you. No, I didn't know he fired, really. I didn't hear any explosion. All I saw was an orange and blue flame.
And what was the next thing that happened?
We went backwards, him on top of me.
Did he fire the gun again?
Yes. This time it was, the first round went to my right, breast, the second one went to my left breast.
Did you feel the impact of the second round?
No.
Did you hear it?
That one I heard. Now, that one I figure was about 12 inches away from me. I heard that one.
Did you continue to struggle with him?
Yes.
And what happened after he fired the second round?
Well, he fired another round. That one, the position I was in, that one went down through my arm.
Did you feel that?
Yes.
And were you able to continue to struggle with him?
Yes. In fact, he fired another round.
And did it hit you?
Grazed off my hip.
What did you feel with that?
I burned.
He had fired at this point four rounds, all four of them striking you?
Yes.
What did he do next?
He thought I was dead. He walked away from me, he walked back towards the sidewalk. And at that time I was up on my knees and saying, Eddie, throw the gun down. With that, his eyes got large. He couldn't believe what he just saw. He looked towards the courthouse and put the gun to his chest and fired.
And what was the result of that?
He flopped over backwards, the weapon went in the snow, probably a foot or so behind his head, and I ran, grabbed the gun.
And what was his condition?
EMTs, everybody got there. I really don't know how, what the length of time was, but apparently he killed himself.
Steve, you have a chance to talk to police officers. What do you tell them about your shooting and the fact that you wore a vest on that day?
Well, I guess for a fact I'm still here talking. They're a damn fool if they don't use them.
What we're going to try to do now is dispel some misconceptions people have about what handgun bullets, and even shotguns for that matter, will do to a running automobile. Contrary to what many people say, the 357 Magnum or even a 44 Magnum will not necessarily stop a running automobile. It is possible, if you get a lucky shot and cut the wire or hit a distributor cap or cut a fuel line, but it's not likely. What we have here is six rounds of 44 Magnum plus six rounds of 357 Magnum, full metal jacket, metal piercing. And that automobile, a $200 special there, is running. And without further ado. Still running. Six rounds, 357 Magnum, if you can hear. The engine slowed down somehow, but it's still running. Well, I did it. Hot fire. What did I hit?
Okay, we're going to go for honesty here in this second chance, as we always have. What happened here, rather than slickness, we're going for honesty. What has happened, we got one lucky shot with the 44 Magnum, came through here, went up into the instrument panel, underneath the instrument panel, and it hit the fuse area. And see, it destroyed the whole fuse assembly, and that cut the ignition to it. So the engine block itself is basically unharmed. And the car did take six rounds of 357 Magnum full metal jackets from a 6-inch barrel and a couple of 44s before, like I said, sort of one lucky shot got in there and clipped the fuse wire, or destroyed the whole fuse system here, wherever this thing is. It's hard to tell because there's not much left of it. Here, it's the fuse system. There it was. So it is possible to stop a car with one of these things, but don't depend on it.
They broke in through the sliding glass door here. They probably used a screwdriver to jimmy the lock. They took my monogram silver that's been in the family for years, and my oil painting that I had here. They took the VCR, the television, and my camera. It was very valuable. My painting's gone. Here's a list. I made a list of all the serial numbers and the descriptions of all the items.
Okay, ma'am, we'll look into it.
On the day you were shot, did you expect anything unusual to take place?
No, I didn't.
And what was your assignment?
I was on routine patrol, and I was dispatched to a suspicious auto and out in the middle of a field. And upon arrival, meeting with a complainant, The young man that I talked to told me that he believed the vehicle had been stolen from the Palatine area. I advised him I was a police officer and told him to stand where they were. I heard the sound of two shots behind me. It was a Remington 1100 12-gauge shotgun, a 28-inch barrel.
How far away were you when you were shot?
Approximately 25 feet.
When you were on the ground, you recognized you'd been hit. What happened next?
I observed the offender to walk up to me within a distance of approximately 5 to 10 feet and fire a third round, which struck in my left shoulder and neck region, just above the clavicle piece.
Could you see him clearly at the time he fired at you?
Yes, I could.
Was that same identification later used to convict this individual for
shooting? Yes, it was.
This was an area that was above your vest, the impact?
Correct.
What was the extent of your injury?
I had a hole approximately 2.5 inches in diameter, right at the base of the neck, where the neck and the shoulder would meet.
Ron, when you were taken to the hospital for treatment, what did the doctors tell you?
Doctors told me that had I not have been wearing the vest, I would not have survived the two shots to the back. Nobody before the shooting ever thought it would happen, but a lot of people woke up since that time and have purchased vests.
And do you remember the day that your husband was shot?
Yes, I do. It was November 14th, 1986.
When you arrived at the hospital, you met Ron.
Yes.
Where was he at?
He was in the emergency room.
Did you get a chance to talk to him?
Yes.
What did he say to you?
He said not to worry that the vest took it all.
You have a chance to tell other wives about what happened to your family, your husband, and the shooting. What do you tell them now?
To, if they don't have a vest, to buy one, and to, if they have one, to make sure their husbands do wear it.
I've got a young lady in your arms there. Will you tell us a little bit about her?
Well, she wasn't around when he got shot. She's only 6 months old, so I guess you'd call her a second chance baby.
And what's her name?
Ashley.
And you've got a big fella sitting over here. Who's this?
This is Patrick.
Today we're going to just do something for the heck of it. Here's another $200 special automobile. We've got some tires, using 38 specials here, and something I frankly have never done before. I want to see what the 38s will do to tires. Will they blow them? Like you see in the movies, we'll try it. Here goes for the rear one. Ready for the rear one? Now, it's slowly leaking. I hear it's slowly leaking, but it's not exploding like you see in the movies. I'll try one more into the rear tire, up about 3 o'clock. Let's go over and take a look here. Yeah. Air is slowly coming out, but it's the car is eminently drivable. And I can't see a guy going into some wild and crazy spin because of this happening. You see it just slowly sinking down here. This was just 125 grain silver tip Winchester 38s. We'll try right on the front tread of the tire, see what it does there. I can hear that is also leaking now too. But the tire does not explode like you see in traditionally held in the movies. It's coming out real nice. I can do some dirt here. See this here. But it's not one of these deals where the car explodes in a ball of flame or anything.
Thank you. tell us your name and where you're from.
Mark Bednarz, Savannah, Georgia.
Mark, how long have you worked in Savannah?
Worked there about a year and a half.
How many men do you have on the police department at that?
About 350 sworn officers.
When you began working in Savannah, were you issued a vest?
Yes, I was.
What type of vest were you issued?
A second chance vest.
Did you wear it every day when you went to work?
Yes, sir, I did.
Do you remember the day of the shooting?
Yes, vividly.
What date was it?
It was April 22nd, 1988.
On the day of the shooting, did you feel that anything unusual was going to take place? Did you expect to be shot?
No, I didn't expect to be shot.
When you next saw him, what was he doing?
When I next saw him, he snatched the door open and had a blue steel revolver in his hand.
What did he do with the weapon?
He shot me at about 3 feet in range.
Did you see the muzzle flash as the weapon discharged?
Yes, I did.
Where did the bullet strike you?
It struck me just at the edge of my vest, right about 2 inches to the left of my navel.
Did you feel the bullet hit you?
Yes, I did.
Did it incapacitate you or stop you in any way?
No, it didn't. I was trying to get out of the way when I saw him, and the combination of me backpedaling and getting hit, I went to the ground.
As you fell to the ground as you backpedaled, did you draw your weapon?
Yes, I did.
What did you do?
I drew my weapon, and keeping the pistol by my hip, I began firing back.
Did you see if you hit him or not?
I saw him going down, so I assumed that I had hit him.
Mark, the subject shot you with a blue steel revolver. What caliber was it?
It was a .357 Magnum.
Do you recall what type of ammunition he shot you with?
It was a 110 grain copper jacketed hollow point.
Was it a .357 Magnum?
Yes, it was.
What was the offender's condition?
The offender was dead on the scene.
First of all, I want to say that I'm much thinner and better looking in person. We've got here our little wooden men here. This is 3/4 inch plywood. It's my sort of personal thing. I feel that if a bullet will penetrate 3/4 inch plywood, it's kind of got a very serious potential for killing you. If it won't penetrate 3/4 inch plywood, it's probably just looking at an irritation. And inside there we have our pickup truck driver. This is again Winchester, typical 38, 125 grain hollow point 38 from a 4 inch barrel. We're going to see what this will do to the door of a pickup truck, and I'm not sure what it'll do really. Take a look. And we have no penetration of a typical cheap pickup car door by a 38. The plywood is untouched. Okay, this is the 220 grain 3/4 jacket Federal 44 Magnum. This ought to go through the car door. Now he goes through, it opens the door for you.
Hi, Mike, are donuts ready?
Yeah, they're right here.
You sure one's not missing?
No, they're all there, man.
Well, what about mine?
Here it is, right here.
Hey, what about the coffee?
Here it is.
Thanks. What about the guys at the station?
No problem. You parked out front?
Yep.
I got you covered.
Where the hell's our ride?
I don't know. He said he'd be here.
Well, how long are we gonna stand here?
I don't know. He should be here anytime.
Who the hell is this anyway? Who is this guy?
He's just a friend.
A friend from where?
Listen, Joe, you didn't get us a ride, did you?
You said you had it covered.
I thought.
What the hell
did.
Am I supposed to do? You said, hey, we got a ride. No problem.
He said
I got
he'd
it covered.
Be here.
Right.
Three 9 6 9 3. I'll be 1097 area. Be out with two subjects in the 700 block of Front Street.
The hell with you guys. Go ahead. Walk. Who needs you? Walk faster.
as far as up to the shooting, I was rather complacent. I didn't take the call serious enough, I don't think, when I got it. After handling so many gun calls or any other call in this job, a guy tends to get a little lax, and I probably got a lot closer than what I should have initially.
On the day that you were shot, did you expect anything unusual to take place?
No. I had some premonitions a couple weeks prior. I was not comfortable going to work, and at that time I couldn't put my finger on it. I didn't know why.
What type of call did you respond to when you were shot?
Disturbance with the possibility of a gun involved.
How many times did you respond to that type of call?
Hundreds. Was this years.
Was this any different than any of the others?
No.
When you got to the scene, was it day or night?
It was nighttime. It was 11:28 p.m.
And what happened when you first encountered the suspect?
I pulled up. There was a suspect and his wife were arguing. He had his back to me, and I pulled up at an angle to the curb and put my spotlight on the man. I was just reaching for my door handle, and he turned around and rushed the car, pulled a gun from shoulder holster, and started firing.
You saw this clearly?
Yes.
How far away was he?
Between 20 to 30 feet.
How close did he get to your car?
By the time he shot me, he was at the hood of the car.
And were you able to still clearly see him?
Oh, yes.
See the gun go off?
Yes.
And what happened at that moment?
I vividly remember seeing the muzzle flash and seeing the windshield open up in front of me.
Did you feel any impact?
I took shrapnel in my face and my arm, and I felt that. However, I never felt around that hit me in the chest.
And where in the chest did it hit you?
Just dead center, right there.
And did it incapacitate you in any way?
No.
And were you able to react after being shot?
Yes, I was able to get the car eventually into drive, knock the assailant over, and then pull across the street.
Did you know that Chris wore a vest when he went to work?
Yes.
And did you check on him when he was going to work to see if he had his vest on?
Not before he got shot. I used to think he was silly sometimes for wearing it to court and stuff, but I would never let him go out of the house now without one. And I heard the sirens all go off, so I got up and looked at the clock to see what time it was, so when he came home that night at 2:30, I could ask him what was going on.
What was the next indication that you had that something might be wrong?
The police officer at my front door.
And what did you think as he came to your front door?
I didn't understand why he was coming there, because he knew Chris wasn't home. He knew Chris was on duty. And it never entered my mind something was wrong with Chris until he asked me if I'd gotten a phone call from dispatch, and I told him no. And at that time, he told me that Chris had been shot, but he was okay. And I remember thinking, how can you be shot and still be okay?
If you had a chance to talk to other police officers' wives, what would you tell them?
Make sure your husband has a vest and he wears it all the time, because you never know when it's going to happen. He didn't leave that night going to work knowing that he was going to be shot. And I had no idea that he would ever need his vest. But now it's a big reality that you'll need it when you least expect it.
Carol, you've got a young fellow in your arms there. Can you tell us about him?
Well, this is Samuel. He was born 10 months after Chris's shooting. And if Chris hadn't been here wearing a second chance vest, we wouldn't have Samuel today.
It was great to be alive.
Yeah.
If you're really tough, what you do now, you grab this barrel with your bare hand, you yell, Kung Fu. Okay, I am not the strongest man in the world. I am stronger than most. That factoid being established, we're going to do some stabbing on vests. All body armor made in the United States, soft body armor that is, has a disclaimer on the label saying, this vest is not good for edged weapons. That means knives. In fact, Second Chance soft body armor has had approximately 200 field impacts with edged weapons. This is the total number of stabbings involving officers wearing the vest. Approximately 100 officers were involved. This number changes almost weekly, so consult our brochure. Assist me in this dissertation on edged weapons. We at Second Chance, and I personally, have done something to try to rehabilitate the criminals of America. We have taken a former street gang member and have been making great efforts by having her stay with me to rehabilitate that person. My assistant will come out here now. Thank you. We'll talk later. Anyway, this is probably more than you're typically going to run into on the street, and it actually is not a good knife to be stabbing through body armor with. Soft body armor can indeed be penetrated by an edge weapon under the three following conditions. You have to have a relatively strong man. And you have to have a very sharp, pointed knife. This is called either a stiletto or a dirk. This design originated in the Middle Ages, and it was designed specifically to penetrate body armor, the chain mail. And this will indeed penetrate chain mail. The third condition is if it is a direct thrust. A slashing thing like this will not do it. Now, this is a razor sharp knife. I would advise you not to do this at home, folks, by the way. But a direct thrust will indeed penetrate if the subject is holding still and if the man that's doing it is strong, if the knife is sharp. We have some assorted body armor. In fact, we'll use one here from a company that claims that their vests are knife proof. This is double thick. And it can be penetrated. However, in normal conditions, normal street fight conditions, we have had over 200 field impacts on edged weapons. In only one case out of over 200 attempts has a knife, and it was a knife such as this, a Gerber Mark I, was able to penetrate. And in that case, the subject was laying on the ground, curled up in a ball, and the attacker then had hit him approximately a dozen times. And finally, about the 13th or 14th stab went through. So the vests are not knife proof. However, they're extremely edged weapon resistant, as we're going to show you. Prop girl. Thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you very much indeed. Oh boy. Anyway, same knife. I just stabbed through a vest, and I can stab through this meat if I get a long thrust on it. Can be done. However, from a short thrust, if a man points a knife at your chest on your vest and says, okay, cop, give me your gun, can't do it. I'm gonna really try to bolt out of here as fast as I can. I can't do it. If it's close like this, you can't do it. The trick is, in a knife fight, is keep moving. Oh, yes. That girl's got the two best-looking legs in America. You know how I know that? I counted them. Okay, my grandfather's World War I knife. A large knife, generally large knives, are not as deadly to soft body armor as soft as the small ones. Was the wrist. But this did not get through. Okay, now we'll try with a sword. This sword is extremely sharp. And we're going to show you that a slashing stroke with even an extremely sharp sword is not going to penetrate. And you see us there, we cut the cover, we cut the inner pad cover, and we cut one layer of the Kevlar. But the man was not hurt by that. And I have bent the sword, honest to God. All those years in Little League paid off, finally. And you definitely would have your day ruined by something like that. Okay, oftentimes we are asked by correctional officers if we could give them a knife-proof vest. This can be done. Often we will advise against it. I'll tend to tell people just to wear their regular second chance, super feather light, deep cover. Because most of the time, most of the knives and edge weapons are probably going to stop. Knife girl, we can make a special vest, thicker, stiffer, that will stop knives. Whew. Anyway, this is it here. This is the same knife I was putting through those other vests. And this is the same hands and everything else. I see the maximum penetration I could get on that was right there. That's hitting that thing as hard as I could. With ordinary vests, even double thick, I can float right through it. So what I advise prison personnel to do would be to go into your evidence locker, wherever you keep these things, and get all the shanks out, everything you've ever been threatened with, and then conduct your own tests. Well, give us a call here at Second Chance. We'll be happy to give you various samples of things that you could stab. Now, one more thing. If you're going to do your own stabbing, your own testing, wear a groin protector here. The Japanese have a word, an expression, to describe somebody who accidentally cuts himself in the stomach. It's very easy to do this, to slip off and let yourself have it. The Japanese expression to describe someone who cuts themselves in the stomach is one dumb shit.
Hello, I'm the man of your dreams. I've come to take you to Las Vegas. You know, we could go to Las Vegas. I'll tell my wife that we're going on a, you know, on a business trip.
Hold it right there, buckle!
Who are you?
We're the Feminist Thought Police.
Feminist Thought Police?
That's right. We're clairvoyant feminists who can read sexist thoughts.
You can
read your mind? Yes, we can.
Ten of clubs.
My God, you can read minds.
That's right, and you're sending out signals like a radio telescope.
There'll be a $50 fine plus other punishments to help rehabilitate you.
Other punishments? What other punishments?
This!
Ah! Oh!
Why are you dressed like that?
Well, to please men.
We'll have to re-educate you.
Come with me.
And if you ever dare try to seduce that young girl again, there'll be 20 lashings with the bullwhip. You understand?
Well, yeah, I was only looking. Could I have them while I'm doing it, maybe?
All right, now try it.
How was that?
Okay, man.
I'm okay, man. He just dusted me. Did you get him?
I don't know, man. I don't know.
How many years have you been on the job?
We've both been there 7 years.
When you first started on the job, were you wearing a vest?
Yeah, we had a vest.
Don, where'd you get your first vest from?
I purchased my first vest from Tidewater Police Supply, which is a distributor in our area for Second Chance.
When you acquired your first vest, was it department policy that made it mandatory that you both wear vests?
No, it was not policy. The department did not issue vests.
When you first put on the vest, what did you think about it?
I thought it was very comfortable. I'd been in a few fights wearing it, and I mean, immediately after I purchased it, and it was quite comfortable. The sheriff and another lieutenant were around the front of the house, and they were going to start banging on the front door and attempt to draw the man's attention up front.
Who hit the door first?
I did. Don was behind me, and it was only three steps and in the door. I hit the door one time. It wouldn't go all the way, so I went in and hit it again. And when the door came open, the man was standing approximately an arm length away when he shot me in the chest.
What did you first see when you went in through the door?
Only thing I could see was a figure of a man standing there. I could tell it was a gun, and it happened so fast that the muzzle flash. And I come back out the door. One thing I think of after he had fired the weapon was to get out.
Did you feel the impact of the round?
I felt it, but my adrenaline was up so much that I wanted to get out.
Kurt, were you incapacitated in any way?
No.
Don, when you saw your partner come out the door, did you know what happened?
Yeah. When he hit the door the second time, it went in, and I heard the shot. And all rights, I thought he was dead. I really did. It's just that quick, and you could hear the explosion and him going out of the house the way that he did. I returned fire a couple of rounds. I turned, was gonna try trying to get him out of the garage, and I look back, and he's standing up, brushing himself off, saying he just burnt me. He just burnt me up, and I could see the pockets on his coat that he was wearing were missing. And he was just brushing himself off, saying he burnt me, he burnt me.
Did he fire at you again?
Yeah.
Yeah, he fired several times. Just at one time, when I was next to the house, he shot me a second time. The doctor stated on his report that if I hadn't had a vest on, that I would be deceased from the first shot.
On the day that you went to this call, did you believe that you'd be shot?
I had no idea.
Throughout the time you'd been wearing your vest, did you honestly believe that it was something that would happen to you?
No, I thought it would never happen to me.
Did any of the other officers that you worked with ever discuss wearing a vest with you?
Yeah, some of them would ask us why we wear them. They said in a small county like we was in, it would never happen. Never knows, never get shot.
Did you have a chance to compare the feel between the two vests?
Yes, I did. I wore second chance vest for quite a few years, and when the vest that Officer Jones was wearing was shot while he was on duty, the department did issue vests. They issued the...
Was it as comfortable as second chance vest?
No, it was not comfortable. The vest doesn't move with you. You feel more like you're in the straitjacket effect of just being held very erect. And in our job as canine handlers, we have to be very mobile in moving over obstacles and such as that. And it just appeared to be very constricting on duty.
Kurt, you bought a new body armor while you're up here. Would you show us what it is and put it on?
Yeah, it's a nylon jacket with a vest type insert. You can wear the jacket, you know, plain, or you can put the vest inside, or you can just wear the vest.
This is a second chance investigator's jacket?
It fits real nice. You can wear it right over your uniform. Even if you're out, if you get called out, you don't want to put your other second chance on, just put it on. You can wear it like this here. Very comfortable.
And if you zip it up, you wouldn't recognize it as being anything other than a windbreaker.
Right, and it's very concealable. The body armor is very concealable. You can't tell I have one on. There's no lines stating in the back that you can see the outline of the vest and the sides. It don't bulge out. You can't even tell I have one on.
And the flap where it says sheriff on the back is Velcro removable?
Yep, the Velcro removable on the back. And you have a Velcro here, we can put your badge, put a cloth badge with Velcro on it, put your patches on both sides. The reason I bought one is because the man who owns Second Chance and who has developed Second Chance, Mr. Davis, he shoots himself with one. And any man who will shoot himself with a pistol, I feel very secure to wear his body armor. I feel like it would be the best because he believes in it, and if he would believe in it to shoot himself with a 44 Magnum, I believe in it to take a hit from him.
Okay, it's type O negative. The interview with Kurt Jones yesterday kind of reminded me of something that I'm probably trying to forget. What we're going to do is show the first actual shooting on the new Second Chance Super Featherweight 2. This is lighter and ounce for ounce stronger than our older vests. We've got two 20 grain Federal 44 Magnums, a 6-inch barrel 44 Magnum. These are not lead bullets. Could use a 4-inch barrel. We're not going to do that. We're going to do it the real thing. Kurt, come on over here. Just in case this doesn't go right, there's my car keys.
Thank you, Richard. Always okay.
Shut the cylinder of the gun here. Feel like Matt Dillon. I'm going to show the power of 44 Magnum here. I guess you saw the dirt flying up in the back. We'll do it again. That's frankly kind of scary. Just in case the thin vest here doesn't work, I'll make sure this bundle of Law & Order magazines that I'm going to use for something to take the shock out of it. Might make sure this bundle of magazines stops the 44 Magnum. Well, guess we better hope the gun doesn't go through the vest. This is the somewhere between 130th and 140th time that I've been shot on Second Chance soft body armor. Hope it's not the last. It's kind of a milestone today. It's the last day of my life as a 44-year-old.
This is September 7th, 1988. Tomorrow, I'll be 45 years old, if all goes well. But the most important word I want you to remember from this whole movie, one word, is comfort. It doesn't matter what your vest will stop. You can stop a 125-millimeter Soviet armor-piercing tank gun. If you're not wearing a vest, you're going to get killed by a 22 or a 25. Comfort is everything. It's more important than stopping power, than price, everything. It's comfort. What we've gone to great lengths to give you is an extremely comfortable vest, extremely thin, extremely light, extremely comfortable, because comfort is everything. We'll take these, we're going to continuously roll here. If you note the tape, be patient with us. We're going to continuously roll. We're going to take the magazines apart here, take the vest apart, show you there's no metal inserts or anything in this. And you guys may have to do this once in a 20-year career with a 38. Sometimes I'm doing this twice a week with a 44 Magnum. So we're going to put a phone book under here and take out some of the shock. And a lot of people think I'm kind of stupid for doing this, but if it's just one knucklehead out there and that this will make the difference to, one guy sees this and says, yeah, maybe I will get one of those, then it's worth it. Easy as pie, guys. Empty. Okay, continue rolling, Alan. Taking this off. Look, it's not going through there. If I can remember how these things work now. This up. Pulling it out. Okay, here's your bullet. You see the impact from the 44 Magnum, severe enough that it actually rips through the water-resistant cover on the back of the pad. There is no metal in this whatsoever. This is the standard second chance super featherweight 2. No metal, no metal in here. And if we've got our magazines, we'll just rip this open. Find it in the yellow pages, eh? You see how the impact was so severe. I'm sorry, this is the penetration of the first one. No metal there at all. I have a joke about why don't they make the phone books out of Kevlar. No metal at all in this thing. I guess you... Whatever. Crash. Anyway, again, the point is not that the bullet stopped. Anybody can make a vest that will stop anything. My grandfather's gravestone will stop a 50 caliber armor piercing. You're not going to wear that. You are going to wear this. This is soft, flexible, comfortable. You can put this on and wear it day after day after day, and you're going to be wearing this thing maybe 3.5 years after you buy it on a night when you don't think anything's going to happen. Bam, putty, that's when it happened. Well, that was fairly easy. Now comes the complicated part. I've got to explain to you how the Federal Bureau of Standards decided to classify body armor. I can tell I'm not too friendly with these people, but they can't count to four without getting lost twice. First, you have Class 1. Now, Class 1 is actually the lowest. You might think that the first class is the best, the wonderful. Well, Class 1 is horrible. Class 1 is like a Pinto with a leaky gas tank and sticky accelerator and bald tires. Wow. Class 1 armor will basically stop ordinary lead 38s and 22s from handguns, and basically not a hell of a lot else. You should not buy a Class 1 vest. It is not a good vest at all. It will not take any kind of Magnum or any kind of 9mm. There's even certain 38s that will go through it. Class 2A. Now that would be about twice as thick as a Class 1 vest. Notice I said 2A, not 2. Basically, a Class 2A vest is sort of what you want. That will stop 357 Magnums, and it will stop American-made full metal jacket 9mm. It also takes a buckshot, and from a distance of about 25 feet or so, it'll take a 12-gauge slug. That'll knock the stuffings out of you, but it'll stop it. Class 2, period, is basically the same as Class 2A, only with about two more layers. Going back here, Class 1, you need about 8 layers of standard Kevlar to pass that. Class 2A, you need about 16. Class 2, you need about 18 or maybe 20 to pass. And Class 2, period, is not so bad. It's a little bit on the thick side, but it's still okay. Class 3A comes next, and that is basically a horrible thing for American policemen to wear. To pass Class 3A, you have to resort to a lot of Kevlar, or laminations, or cross-stitching. And it's very easy to defend a thick vest. It's nice to say, well, we want to give the men the best. We want a good, thick, solid vest that'll really stop those bullets. And that's fine if you wore the bloody thing. But what has happened over and over and over again in this country? American policemen have been issued Class 3A vests, and even some cases Class 2 vests, and they can't wear them. I mean, they can wear them, but again, 3.5 years from now, when they don't think they're going to be shot, they don't wear it, and they get killed. Not by some overloaded 44 Magnum, not by some exotic metal-jacketed, armor-piercing 9mm. They get killed by some stupid punk with a stupid gun, 38 and under. That's what's killing policemen. They're not dying at the rate of about 50 a year, gentlemen. Believe it, more than one a week are being killed, not because something goes screaming through their vest, but because they didn't wear the thing in the first place. This is killing policemen. And about every 2 years, the Bureau of Standards comes up with another standard, and they make it a little bit tougher. They say, well, and it sounds good. We're making it tough on those body armor makers, those dirty rotten guys. They try to get away with something. We make it tough. We make them make a good vest. Anybody can pass these standards. You just keep heaping on Kevlar, throw on laminations, cross-stitch the thing all the hell, and you'll pass it. But nobody's going to wear it, and everybody gets killed. Okay, further on the Bureau of Standards, and you can't blame these guys too much because your Bureau of Standards, you're looking for busy work. I mean, how many times can you weigh your kilogram and measure your meter stick? They're looking for something to do to justify their existence. It's also not enough to simply stop the bullets. You have to have a minimized of what they call blunt trauma. Every guy you've seen here in this film was wearing a vest which did not meet the Bureau of Standards for blunt trauma. In other words, they call it back face deformation signature. That's a government-funded word for dent. The bottom line in this whole thing is, Second Chance Company makes only about 20% of the body armor in this country. Yet we have made approximately 75% of all the saves, where man actually wears the thing and goes out there, hey, man, what was that? Actually wears it and goes out there and gets shot. You've seen some of the guys here. As this tape is being made, we have saved over 400 American law enforcement officers. Nobody else even comes remotely close. Why is this? Am I such a great guy or something? I'm such a great salesman? No, I don't ever wear a tie hardly. It's because the vests are comfortable and you can wear the thing. And comfort is everything.
Okay, men, two more things. I've been getting a lot of flack from the Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. Allegedly, you guys are shooting cats. Another thing, the city council's all over my back about all the damage to the police cars. So let's take it easy.
Yes, sir.
What was the first activity that brought you into contact with the offender?
Well, initially we had an alarm go off for a robbery at a local store, larger than a mom and pop, more like a local grocery market, and they had broadcast a robbery at that scene.
Did they give a description of a vehicle and an offender?
Yes, they did, and initially I knew, as soon as I heard it, I knew what it was going to be anyway, and I had positioned myself to cut him off from what I figured to be his escape route.
And when you positioned your vehicle, how long was it after that that you first sighted his vehicle?
Probably 3 minutes, 4 minutes, not very long. He had a distance of 3 or 4 miles to cover.
Did you have any other backup units with you at the time?
No.
And how close was your closest assistance?
After the entire events were over, it took him about 3.5 minutes, I think, to get up there. And then as we skidded to a halt, he bailed out of the car and came running back to my car door. And as I was getting out of the car, I had just barely got stood up. I had already had my gun unsnapped and out and was just coming up with it when he fired his first shot that hit me right here in the chest. He shot me from barrel to me probably 18 inches.
Would it be something close to where we're sitting right now?
Yes.
Your weapon was in your hand at that time?
Yes.
When you were struck by the round in your chest, what did you feel?
Well, initially, I could feel that the thud of the thing against me, and I could tell that I was hit, but it was more like somebody had popped you with maybe a hammer or something, as opposed to what you would think of about a bullet striking you.
After the shot was fired, were you incapacitated or slowed down in any way?
No, not at all.
What did you do?
I shot him twice while we were still standing.
And what type of weapon were you carrying?
Smith & Wesson 4-inch 41 Magnum Model 58.
And do you recall what type of ammo you were carrying that day?
Remington Peters 210 grain soft point.
What did he do when you hit him?
He fell to the ground more or less at my feet and sprawled out. He began screaming and cussing at me, shooting up at me, shooting to the interior portion of my car as I stood in front of the door, shooting down into him. And as he would shoot one round, I would shoot one round, and he was waving his python back and forth. And as he would wave it near me, I would turn a little bit one way or the other to clear where the barrel was, and then I would shoot him again.
Do you recall seeing the muzzle flashes from the gun?
Oh, yeah.
Did he hit you again?
No.
After the shooting, were you able to determine what type of ammunition he had in his revolver?
They were 110 grain. Remington Peters also, I think.
Were they 357 mags?
357 magnums, yeah.
Okay, next we're going to try something that's very common in police work, a 12-gauge shotgun. We're using the 2 3/4-inch 00 buck magnum. That's 12 pellets of 33 caliber each. And we're going to fire this at the door of a car. Let's go take a look. Okay, even with the window rolled up, you have no penetration of a 3/4-inch plywood. You had three pellets come through, or parts of pellets, looks like. Yeah, three pellets and a couple little fragments. They struck the plywood, but two of them just bounced off the plywood and one of them is stuck in the plywood. So you might consider that to be kind of marginal at shooting at a guy in a car. Now we're gonna try a 12-gauge slug, the same target. And, as you can probably guess, yes indeed, we have massive damage. This is a clean, piece of cardboard. Massive hole. You can see this. right through. Ow. Massive clean hole right through the target. That would definitely kill somebody. Okay, one more, rightly or wrongly, it's increasing in popularity among police officers, is the 9mm, 9x19, 9mm Luger, various names. It's a marginal bullet. One long suit that the 9mm has is it's very good on penetration for a bullet its size. We'll show this on the car door here. This is a 12 gauge slug, but we only have one penetration. This surprised me. You only have one bullet, and that bullet I just pulled it out of the plywood. So I was kind of surprised there. Those four shots, only one got through, and that was very marginally effective. I doubt that would have really hurt anybody very seriously at all. Let's do something that Jeff Cooper wouldn't do. We'll give the 9mm a second chance. Little plug there, folks. Well, we got a few more through that time. And we did. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we got total of six penetrations of the plywood that time, and shows, I guess, you can't get through it. Back to our basic premise about car doors, they are not homogeneous. They're all different parts in here. There's all kinds of safety bars and everything, and gears and everything, so you cannot depend on saying one bullet will always do this and another bullet will never do this. From the sexual habits of a politician or an evangelist to the innermost workings of an electron, the truth is probably the most fragile and elusive thing in our universe. It can be bent, distorted, turned around. It can be destroyed. What we're going to try to show you now today is some of the ways the truth is distorted about bulletproof vests. Here's two pieces of concealable body armor. Identical bullets. Ooh. Well, what happened here? This vest clearly stopped the bullet, and this one let it go through. Why is that? Two identical vest pads. Now this has been done by salesmen from other companies. And the trick is that this pad has two layers of Kevlar and about 14 layers of cotton inside the thing. We labeled it here cotton. We're going to burn this right after the tape is made. This is the Israeli Eagle brand black nose 9mm. It's given a black nose as though it was armor piercing. It in fact is not armor piercing. It's just a very adequate ball ammo. This is a nice gun, a Steyr 5 1/4 inch 9mm. And these two ballistic pads are identical. You can see those bullets did stop in that ballistic pad. And you can see very painfully so, these bullets did not stop in the ballistic pad. The trick here is that the ammunition was not the same. Even though all I have left in this gun is the Israeli ball ammunition, what I really fired on these second two shots was a rare Finnish and Swedish Army issue armor-piercing 9mm, which will, in fact, penetrate every bit as well as a KTW ammo. And now, the great Alfredo is going to do another trick for you. Here's six rounds, 44 Magnum, rather hot loads, but they're all identical. And
44 Magnum. Spin the cylinder here. Spin it again. We're gonna make this vest look good, and gonna make this vest look bad. These pads are absolutely identical, and I could do this in front of you. Nope, no question about it, the pads are absolutely identical. How do you do that? Look at the bullets. There you go. Identical bullets. And I'm not going to tell you. One thing I do want to point out, we're using a very warm plastilina, which greatly exaggerates the impact. But these were very powerful 44 Magnum loads. There's the remaining bullets. Because there's so many ways to deceive somebody in a demonstration, and I've only shown you three of them here, there's many more. At Second Chance, I've felt for the last 15 years that the best way for a policeman to believe in the vest is to get a free test sample. And at this point in time, to the best of my knowledge, as the guy used to say, we are the only company that will actually give you a free test sample. Just give us a call, and it's yours for the asking. And also, we send one free test sample with every vest that you buy. There's two good reasons for this. One, it cuts down all the baloney and lies that other companies tell about Second Chance. And two, on those extremely rare occasions where an officer is carrying some kind of incredibly overloaded Magnum round that would penetrate his body armor, he should know about it before he starts wearing it. No one likes to think about this, but approximately 20% of all law enforcement officers killed in the United States are shot with their own handgun or with their partner's handgun. So again, it's very irritating to think about, but of all the guns in the world, the one you are most likely to be shot with is your own.
Officer that shot Godzilla?
Well, yes, I am.
Was Godzilla armed?
Well, no, but he was huge.
Well, did you fire a warning shot?
No.
Well, did you shoot to wound?
No, this guy's huge.
So, you killed Godzilla in cold blood?
Well, I had to, lady, he's a reptile.
Deputy, I represent the Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Large Amphibious Monsters, and you, sir, are in deep trouble.
I represent the owner of the building Godzilla fell on.
We had turned on a car to pull him over for defective equipment. He had a taillight out. We were just going to let him know that he had a taillight out.
How many times in the past have you stopped a car for defective equipment?
Numerous times. I couldn't even be. I've stopped a lot of cars for defective equipment.
As you approached the driver's side of the door, what happened?
I got up just brought to the door post. Before I could ask him for his driver's license or for his paperwork, he came across his chest with a .22 rifle. There were no words spoken. He shot four times.
And where were you hit?
I was hit twice in the chest, once in the stomach. All three of those were vest stop, and then once through the right arm.
Did you feel the impact of the bullets?
I felt like I was being peppered. I didn't know how many times I'd been hit. Because while he was shooting, my partner was returning fire, and I didn't know how many shots had rang out. I could feel it was like somebody was hitting me in the stomach and chest area.
Were you incapacitated?
I think it was a state of mind where I was in shock or disbelief. I fell back. I did go down. My partner returned fire, and then I was able to shoot six times as the vehicle pulled away. Well, he had a history of mental problems, as what we found out. We didn't know at the time. He was just passing through the area. we had no idea who the man was until we did a background investigation on him.
Was there anything unusual in his vehicle other than the 22 rifle he had?
Yes, he had a sawed-off shotgun that was loaded and ready to go. He had a bunch of knives. We found out later that it appeared he had himself a shelter. There was a clipboard with a scenario that appeared that he was on his way to go into the thumb area of Bay City, Michigan, and possibly shoot a police officer.
Well, John, we understand that you've had occasion in the past to meet with some of the superheroes and great evil monsters of this universe. Is that true?
Well, I had an opportunity yesterday to do this.
And who was it you saw?
It was Godzilla I ran into.
Had he come across on the transatlantic flight, or do you know if he swam?
Yeah, I don't know how he came across.
No. I heard you've met him in the past. One was a DUI complaint. Is that true?
That was years ago, yeah.
I understood that there may be a little bad blood between you and him.
There was, yes.
I understand his blood is green, though.
Yes, but I understand.
Did you have any knowledge that on the day that when you got up yesterday morning that Godzilla might be around?
I had no idea, no.
As far as Godzilla in general, is there a certain way to approach him?
Well, no. I thought that the weapon I used was about the best way to take him out at the time.
And what was it that you were using on the day you saw him?
You'd have to ask Mr. Davis that. He was the one that gave me the weapon.
Was this one of these special weapons that Richard invented in his basement in his spare time?
It must have been. It was a super weapon.
This could have been something like the subatomic particle nuclear generator?
I believe it's what he called it, yeah.
I understand Godzilla has great fear of that.
He doesn't have any fear anymore. But
none?
No.
What happened?
We knocked him down. Took him out.
It's good news. I'm sure all the boys and girls around the land who are fans of Gamora, the giant turtle, that is arch nemesis, will be glad to hear that.
they were all happy about it.
Well, we're real happy about it too, John. Thanks a lot. I want to shake your hand. That's a tough thing to do.
Okay.
Thank you.
My name is Archie Urich, Grant County Sheriff's Department, Medford, Oklahoma.
What's your job there?
I'm sheriff.
The sheriff, not one minion or anything. You're the sheriff.
Sheriff, overpaid deputy, whatever.
Yeah. The guy everybody yells at if things go wrong.
Oh, this is my wife, Sue Ann.
I'm getting her. It's Sue Ann. On the day you were shot, Archie, did you expect to get shot?
No, I didn't.
Never did. What did it feel like when the 44 Magnum hit you?
Like a mule kicking me.
Yeah. The interesting story, when you shot him, you had a 9mm, we found out now. You were shooting a 9mm at the assailant?
I was shooting a 9mm at that time.
As he ran away, and it was good distance?
No, it was approximately 25 yards, 30.
Okay, with someone else's 9mm. They found later that you had actually hit him once. Where'd you hit him?
I hit him in the left rear end. Went to about $5,000.
He had over $5,000 in cash in his wallet.
Yeah, in his wallet.
And the 9mm bullet just barely made it through all that.
It went through it and did penetrate his
large
flesh.
His fleshy part back there. I got one of those fleshy parts myself, yeah. The original call out there, now what was that for?
It was a warrant on grand auto theft.
You didn't realize this guy was into, what was he into actually?
He was into drugs, narcotics. He was a heavy distributor of methadone, crank. He's lots of thefts. He took to California and traded for crank and brought back and distributed that factor, but he was into anything and everything.
Did you hear the shot that hit you?
No, I didn't.
You did. Your partner, what's his actual height and weight approximately?
He's approximately 400 pounds, 7 foot.
7 foot tall and 400 pounds.
And then that time he started coughing and pieces of his lungs started hitting the dash. Yeah, well, three Oklahoma Bureau of Narcotic Agents.
Okay, and they found the guy out in the woods, and the story is that they told him to surrender, and that he didn't. He came up shooting?
He did come up shooting, and at that time he returned fire with fully automatic weapons.
Everybody just unloaded on him all at once.
That's true.
That wasn't very sporting, was it?
No, but he wasn't going to give them a chance either.
Archie, you got your vest on now. You're worried about
I had my
you?
Vest on. No, I'm not worried about you, Richard, because you shoot yourself all the time anyway. Okay.
A lot of people ask me why do I continue shooting myself, including my friends, my family, even my cardiologist. Here's one reason, and if that's not good enough, I got 400 more. Salesmen for other companies over the last 15 years have been putting out the false rumor that I have been killed in a demonstration. And there's actually a good reason for this. It's because they don't want to really follow my act. They are perhaps just a professional salesman, nothing more, nothing less, and they're not the dedicated fanatic that I am. And it's understandable they don't want to turn the gun on themselves and get shot. So if you've heard the rumor that Richard Davis has been killed or wounded in a demonstration, there's a toll-free number you can call, 800-253-7090, and find out if I'm dead or not. I've kind of devoted my life to creating a concealable body armor for the American policeman, and the possibility does exist that someday I would lose my life trying to get you to wear it. I don't think that will happen, but even if it did someday, it will have been worth it. There are occasionally some people in business and government who claim that they invented soft body armor. Well, who says Second Chance invented soft body armor? Well, the United States Patent Office, for one.
It's unlikely that you, as a law enforcement officer, would ever run into a suppressed or silenced weapon. But in case you ever do, we're going to try to give you somewhat of an idea what they sort of sound like. No weapon, of course, is truly silent, because just the action of the gun itself going off, the mechanics of the gun makes noise. The bullets make noise when they actually hit something. So here's the 9mm. Without a suppressor, of course. And here's a 9mm, MAC-10 it is, with a suppressor. If you listen closely, if this sound comes through, you can actually hear the bullets impacting on the trees in there. Further, here's a .22 without a suppressor. And with a suppressor. Gentleman's weapon, you don't need earmuffs. Watch, you can listen, you can hear it hit the car here. You heard it hit the steel plate down there. There is a gun that is even quieter than this. They call it the Alexis Carrington gun. You pull the trigger, and all you can hear is slut, slut, slut.
My first thought was just another John trying to pick up a hook. My intentions were to lock them both up.
driver's license registration, please?
Is there a problem, officer?
Yes, sir. You have your license registration.
Did I do something wrong?
Yes, sir.
Got him. I got him.
Ted, this is the one scene we actually did at the actual location where you were shot.
That's correct.
This is the exact same spot.
Yeah, that's correct.
You must feel the adrenaline going through your body pretty good right now, eh?
Yeah.
You're a detective now, though, right?
That's correct.
Can you tell us something about the gentleman that you perforated there?
Well, when I was in the hospital, I understand the Detroit Police Department were holding two murder warrants for him, and they had him suspected in several other murders. My last count, when I talked to the officials there, were about 11 other murders that they were able to confirm.
So that'd be, what, 13 altogether?
No, they were 11 altogether.
Oh, 11 altogether?
That they were able to confirm, yeah.
He's probably done more than that, even, if you don't know about.
That's a good possibility.
So this guy's actually an honest-to-God professional killer?
Yeah, my understanding, he was labeled as a narcotic hitman. Yeah, he tried to make me number 12.
From the time you first saw the gun, okay, until he fired, about how long was that?
A fraction of a second. It was just that fast.
Okay.
And he hit me once.
Uh-huh. You still got a little scar from that?
Yes.
And everything. How many shots did you fire?
I discharged 6 rounds.
6 rounds, and you had how many hits?
Four
hits, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
I think the national average is about 25%.
Yeah.
It's ironic, when I had to shoot some guys, I had 4 hits out of 6 shots, so.
And here comes this drunk from up under the hood. And
the car's giving birth.
Yeah, and I said, get out. The guy shot me, he's got a gun. Okay, and I got back on the radio, and I gave my location again.
This is one of my favorite stories of all the second chance saves. Here, this man's a professional killer, and now he shot you, and you shot him back, and he died at the wheel of his car.
Yeah.
And here he is dead at the wheel of the car, and he's banging into other cars. He's dead, and he's still causing trouble.
Well, he won't cause no more.
One of our earlier second chance saves was stabbed with a pitchfork. Ready? And that did not penetrate. Give him another one. Ready? Anyway, now without the vest, Mr. Beef is going to have a much harder time of it here. A lot of people talk in terms of shooting people with handgun bullets of knockdown power. What is knockdown power? Is it possible to physically knock somebody down? We have here is about 56 pounds of meat with our 2.5-3 pound vest on it. This is a 44 Magnum using the new Federal HydroShock 44 Magnum ammunition. And we're going to shoot the vest, and we'll see how far this 56 pounds of meat will move when hit with a 44 Magnum. Are you ready? You see, not very much at all. 56 pounds of beef, that corresponds to, I don't know what, 5 or 6 year old kid. And this beef was barely moved. So there is basically no such thing as knockdown power in the strictest physics sense. There is such a thing as shock power. There is such a thing as killing power. And those are sometimes different things. For a bullet to have enough energy to physically knock a human being backwards, the bullet would have to be so powerful that the man who fired the shot was also knocked backwards. That's simple physics, and you can't get away from it. We're going to show you something today about penetration. There's infinite number of things that can be said, infinite number of rounds and combinations of things to penetrate. But today we're going to show you something that perhaps could be common to you. So you're an officer and you're being shot at by a bad guy from a building. Should you hide behind a phone pole if you have the opportunity to do so? Well, it depends on what the guy is shooting. We have here a standard AR-15 rifle, except for the exotic material we made the stock out of. It's called wood. And 55 grain ball ammo. This is the 1-in-12 twist barrel. All right. I'm going to fire at the foam pole here with a target behind it. And let's take a look. One shot, so we're empty. Standard 223 ball
or soft point for that matter, ammunition, will not penetrate foam poles, generally. Now we've got Mad Dog Chudwin here with a SS-109 armor-piercing ammo. This is a special rifle barrel he had put in his AR-15. It's a 1-in-7 twist, so it spins the bullet a little faster, more stability, plus there's a steel core in the bullet. Okay, clear. Okay, clear and empty. And we'll take a look. I think you saw there. One, anyway, at least one out of those three rounds was able to penetrate the foam pole. But it wasn't really much penetration. It penetrated, but not enough to go through 3/4 inch of plywood. So in the case of an AR-15, it probably would behoove you to hide behind a foam pole if you're skinny enough to get your vitals behind this. We also have done this on a standard log. It's not treated like a foam pole is, and we had penetration, even from the NATO ball. So it's a very chancy thing, if you will. Next, we're going to show a 12-gauge Remington slug. And as you might expect, nothing at all. Next is a 308 soft point ammo, not full metal jacket. We'll take the magazine out there. And we did not have penetration of the pole. Next is 308 or 7.62 by 51 NATO ball. It's a full metal jacket round. And it's a little different story there, as you can obviously see. We do have a penetration with the 308 ball full metal jacket.
The purpose of what I'm trying to illustrate to you here today is to show you
Sir, you're obviously intoxicated. You need to go with me.
Shit. Well, I like this son of a bitch up.
Jim, on the day you were shot, did you suspect you were going to be shot?
No.
Never thought about it at all?
No indication whatsoever.
What were you originally stopping this guy for?
It was a traffic stop for DWI.
He's weaving around a bit and everything? Uh-huh. Generally goofy driving, huh?
And all over the road.
The interesting thing we've had, you're the last case we're reenacting. Several of the other men have said they did not hear the shot that hit them, even though it was a Magnum at close range. Did you hear the gunshot that hit you?
No, I did not.
That's amazing. We're running into something there. Did you hear your shots when you're shooting back at them?
Didn't hear shots through the whole encounter.
You can't remember hearing them, actually. Yeah.
No.
That's strange, yeah. Jim, when you were struck, did you feel the impact of the bullet then?
The first round in the chest, I didn't even feel it.
Didn't even feel it?
No.
Where exactly did it hit you then?
Just about where this hole is here.
Yeah, right here. Just where we depicted it, right. Mm-hmm. And then you turned around, and where'd the second round strike you in the back?
In the back. I felt that one.
Your case is one that's going to be quoted a lot, I think, by the various proponents and opponents of the 9mm. What ammunition exactly were you using?
It was a PMC full jacket. It was a hollow point,
But it was a full metal jacket where the bolt, the jacket goes down into the cavity.
Right.
It was 125 grain.
Okay, now you fired about a magazine and a half. What gun did you actually have?
It was a Smith & Wesson Model 59.
Okay. How many times total did you hit him in the torso?
I believe there were 17 rounds total.
17 total torso hits?
Yes.
Amazing. We only depicted 12 here because people would think we were exaggerating. And after 17 torso hits with 9mm hollow points, he
was still going.
Was still going, and he was trying to get that. Now, the gun as we showed it there was exactly what kind of gun?
In his
pickup truck lockbox.
Okay, he was carrying a Taurus 4-inch 357.
A Taurus 4-inch 357. It's portrayed by a Ruger stainless steel. I won't say that in camera. the gun that was in the toolbox of the pickup truck.
Okay, that was a 45 semi-automatic commando carbine.
And was that loaded?
Yes.
The round in the chamber and everything?
Yes, it was fully loaded and he had 500 rounds of ammo extra for you.
500 rounds. The subject here, tell about his condition, what you found out later.
Okay, he had a 0.22% blood alcohol and he had terminal cancer. And he stated that he was coming to Arkansas to die.
Wow. He got his wish, I guess, anyway. What is your opinion of the 9mm handgun? I'm not selling those, so I guess... And you aren't either, so you're an impartial expert.
Impartial expert. I feel like if I'd have had something with a little more punch to it, the man would have gone down.
If you had to say exactly the same thing over again, would you rather have had a 357 Magnum or a 45?
Preferably a 45.
You would have rather had a 45. That's understandable. Imagine after you got up to the guy, you had, 17 torso hits
on
this man. And then you had how many more in the face?
There were two headshots.
Two headshots. That settled it then.
Yes.
Yeah, Jim, one other unusual thing about your case was his relatives. What happened there?
They came to the police department to pick up his personal effects, and they also wanted to talk to me, which I was rather reluctant to do that at first, but what it was, they wanted to apologize for the actions.
Yeah, they had stated that he had tried to kill himself probably about a week or so before, and they had talked him out of it. He took his gun away from him and he left.
They talked him out of it.
They talked him out of it, and they were sorry because it had caused so much trouble to hurt people.
There's some speculation he was going to take that 45 carbine and the 500 rounds of ammo and just see how many people he could kill.
Yes, that state CID investigator with state police, that was his theory, that the man was going to go out in a blaze of glory somewhere.
Oh, he got exactly zero anyway. So I'm real proud of that, actually. Did the suspect himself ever apologize to you?
No, he did not.
Surprise, this is how we at Second Chance see the American law enforcement officer. This is what you are to us, a human body, lungs, and a heart, a liver. Liver hits are particularly damaging. Stomach, large intestines, kidneys. This story does not have a happy ending. Less than a year ago, a Lansing City police officer got a call of a disturbance wherein basically just a cranky old man had taken the sled of a small child who had trespassed across his land here. It was in a very low crime neighborhood, and the department sent a lone woman to the scene to resolve things. It could have been resolved peacefully, but the man took the sled inside that garage because he was irritated at the children for trespassing on his land. And instead of simply returning the sled, he came out of the garage, not with the sled, but with a 44 Magnum carbine. He shot the female officer on her Second Chance vest, just below the right breast. The vest is not rated to stop a 44 Magnum carbine. It did, in fact, stop the 44 Magnum carbine. The vest worked. She drew her 38 revolver. She worked. She pointed the 38 revolver at the man. She shot him twice. She was using Major Brand 125 grain jacketed hollow point plus P ammunition. She got two solid torso hits. One ended up only an inch from his spinal cord. The vest worked, she worked, the gun worked. The bullets failed. The man did not respond to the impact of the .238 specials in his torso. He returned fire, shot her in the face with a .44 Magnum carbine and killed her. And she died right here where I'm standing. Because of this incident, I decided to do something that I have been sitting on for over 10 years. There's a Shakespearean line which says, cry havoc and turn loose the dogs of war. Stopping people with a bullet is very hard. Saving lives is very hard. Killing is easy. Because of this incident, I created a bullet, which we call Thunder Zap, which is frankly quite hideous. And we're going to show you something about it now. If you are armed with a Magnum or a .45 automatic, consider yourself lucky. This is a .44 Magnum with the Hydroshock hollow point bullets. We're going to shoot this into two layers of ribs here. Well, you see, that's quite devastating. The problem is, so many officers are armed with a .38 special. And here we have a very poor example of it, a very well-used, quite old .38 Colt Police Positive. Is it possible to give the .38 special sufficient, not stopping power, shocking power, killing power, whatever, enough to knock the socks off anybody? That's probably just as scientific a term as anything else. And up to now, it hasn't been. Two friends and I have developed a new bullet. We call it Thunder Zap. It travels from a 4-inch barrel at a velocity, and I know some of you are not going to believe me now. It travels at a velocity of over 2,800 feet per second from a 4-inch barrel. At a distance of 100 yards, you can catch this bullet in your hand. At close range, inside of 21 feet, where almost all your handgun fights occur, it is extremely devastating, as we'll show you. Now keep it running, Alan. The hit in the top on each case was from the .44 Magnum. The hit on the bottom was the .38 Special Thunder Zap. That's fired from an ordinary, relatively weak gun, .38 Colt Police Positive. This is not the bullet you would want to use if you're going out to hunt grizzly bear. The penetration is very moderate on this. There is an extreme possibility that you would not kill somebody with this. A very large man being shot off center could possibly survive that quite easily. If you keep on shooting him, though, he's not going to, but the idea here is that we have a bullet that if you hit the person you're shooting at, it will knock the daylights out of them, stop the fight instantly. But if you miss, if it hits concrete, the side of a building or the concrete street, it'll shatter and it won't hurt any innocent bystanders. If you miss the guy entirely and it goes, you know, anything I think beyond 50 yards has very slight chance of being fatal on anybody. So if you're in a gunfight with a handgun and the bad guys are, you know, 40, 50 yards away, by all means switch to another more conventional ammo. This stuff will not carry beyond 100 yards. And at 75 yards or more, it just comes down like snowflakes. At the close ranges of inside of 10 yards, as you just saw, it is hideous. And God help the person that's hit on the arm or even the leg with this. And in a philosophical sense, God forgive me for creating it.
The home of Ron Jagielski in Detroit. Ron, how long ago were you shot?
1973.
That's, what, about 15 years ago?
15 years ago.
When the impact of the 38 Special hit you, what did you feel?
I felt like I got stung by a bee.
You did something right there that was unusual inside the felon's apartment. Remember that? You went and called your wife.
Yeah, I went and called her, and I told her, I says, don't panic, but I says, it'll be on TV that I got shot.
And you called
her? She asked if I was drinking.
And, yeah, you stepped over the body of the guy that shot you and went and used his telephone.
Right.
How many brothers and sisters do you have now?
Two brothers and one sister.
Are you the oldest, or?
Yeah.
You're the oldest. There was two born after your dad was shot.
Well, three.
Three. Well, the one was already on the way. There's two born afterwards. That's nice. Ron, when you first bought your second chance, you were one of the very first people in America to buy concealable body armor and to wear it on duty. When you first bought it, did you ever think you were really going to be shot?
I really had no idea. I had no idea, but I didn't want to take that chance. The city wasn't going to foot the bill for it, and there were a group of us at the precinct who decided to buy our own. We heard about it and tried, tested, and proven. And of course, I was the first one in actuality that proved it body-wise, you know. But I was, you know, I relive it quite often. Quite often.
You broke ground for a lot of policemen. Indirectly, you've no doubt saved a lot of policemen who saw, heard about your case in the beginning.
Well, the day they heard about it, the day I was at the hospital, word got around real fast, and there were policemen coming from all over the city to see if it in fact was true that, you know, that the vest did stop, you know, the bullet, and it did, and I guess that's when sales went up a little bit for you, and saved a number of lives in the interim.
You're a detective where now, Ron?
Over at the 6th Precinct.
Okay, so
that's where I've been the entire, my entire career.
Okay. You got to know the area pretty good by then.
Oh, yeah.
I like your outfit there. You wrote Mike Hammer, the hat and the trench coat and everything.
Sledgehammer.
Yeah, sledgehammer. Show him your gun. Show him your sledgehammer gun. He, this is a, what are you carrying?
45 long Colt.
Okay.
Definite man stopper.
Beautiful gun, too.
In Detroit, that's what you need.
Yeah. How many more years you got to go?
About four and a half.
Four and a half for retirement.
Then I'm done.
Okay.
Then I go up to God's country, hunt fish. Act like a fool, drink beer.
Sounds good.
Now the question is, will the impact from this 38 be enough of hydrostatic shock to stop a person's heart or to kill him or to break the rib? Any number of things could happen. We've debated this with doctors and everybody else. There's only one way that you can find this out. To do it. I'm going to fire this into a second chance nylon armor. You have no metal in here. We'll cut this away afterwards to show you. And we'll assume that those guys over there at the bowling pins are the ones that are doing the shooting on me. And if the shock is not enough to knock me out or kill me, we'll try to kill the bowling pins and find out whether this thing works or not. If it does, we can save 1,000 men in the next 10 years. If it doesn't, they're going to die, as I will. Okay. It stings, it's enough to make you mad. Okay, I have the skin broken. The gun is embedded here in the nylon. The muzzle flash has caused some bleeding on my right wrist.
Looks like number four shot to me. We're in an alley off Pennington in West Outer Drive. I was born about 10 miles over that way in Highland Park. I grew up about 5 miles southwest of here. Ron Jagielski lives about 7 miles straight west of here. I was shot for the first time on Second Chance about 25 miles to the northwest in Walled Lake. Ron Jagielski was shot about 6 miles south of here. It's not even dark yet, and we've already heard two gunshots off in the distance. This is Detroit. It's no place for wimps. In 1969, the night before Apollo 11 blasted off to take the first men to the moon, I had to do some blasting of my own. Right here in this spot, I defeated two men in a gunfight. Unfortunately, I was fighting three at the time. Laying on the operating table, I said to myself, there's got to be another way. At the funeral of a law enforcement officer killed in the line of duty, there is an emotion which runs as strong as the emotions of grief and sorrow. That emotion is one of frustration. If only there was something, anything we could do, anything to turn back time and make it not happen, anything. There is something you can do. The only catch is you have to do it before the funeral. Wear one of these, not just for your own survival, but to help ensure the survival of those who work with you. There are some of you out there watching this right now who are going to be shot to death. And nobody knows who you are. But it does not have to happen. You are the first generation in the long and bloody history of law enforcement to have at your disposal a practical device which will prevent about 3/4 of all police killings and critical woundings. I have done everything I can think of, from pies in the face to Magnums in the heart, to get you to wear this. So please do it. Appropriately, comfortable, concealable, everyday body armor started right here in a dark alley. And the movie ends here. But the job of law enforcement and the fight for officer survival has no beginning and it has no end. It will simply continue.